Thank you to the praise team. These are great songs, aren't they? Affirmation of what we believe. And I suppose, in a sense, they're relatively easy to sing, but the rubber hits the road when we try to live them out in our daily lives. We're continuing our series, as Jamie said, on the doctrine of God, person and work of the Holy Spirit. And as he alluded to in his prayer, these are massive subjects. I mean, they're huge, what we've been looking at over the last number of weeks. And the hope is we can't cover everything. It's just impractical in the time given. But I suppose the hope is that we're inspired in our own personal time with the Lord to go away and study more and read more and pray that God would speak to us as we would get into his word together. And also tonight, this is a massive subject. I don't imagine that I'm going to say very much that possibly many people haven't heard before. But actually, being reminded of these great truths and how they are lived out in our lives are important. And that's been the case for me over the last couple of weeks, looking at it, praying into it, and studying it. And I hope that that'll be the case for you as well. So the title I was given for tonight was He Shall Testify. And that's from John 15:26. When the Counselor comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. And what I intend to do tonight is just look at this over with sort of three broad sweeps. Who is the Holy Spirit? What does he do? And then what difference does, or rather maybe what difference should that make in our day-to-day lives? One of the earliest memories I have of watching a film was Star Wars, the original Star Wars, A New Hope. And there's a very iconic scene, and you'll picture it if you've seen it, where at the very end of the film, if you haven't seen it, I'm going to spoil it for you, but that's the way it goes. It was out in 1970, so you've had plenty of time to watch it. But at the end of it, there's, you know, Luke Skywalker and the X-Wing fighter, and he goes down into the sort of exhaust shaft of the Death Star. And the idea is that the wee tracking computer, you know, we think it's right over the eye, and in the high-resolution, high-tech 1970 graphics, as the wee rubbish-looking white lines get closer and closer and closer to the thing that he has to fire the lasers into. But as he's making a sort of run in there, this voice of his old mentor, Obi-Wan Kenobi, keeps coming over in his mind, you know, use the force, Luke, use the force. And he sort of resists it initially, and then it comes back again, and he disengages the wee computer system, uses the force, fires the blasters, and the Death Star is obliterated. It's magnificent. That's, I mean, a really good movie. But I suppose the danger is sometimes that we think of the Holy Spirit in those terms, like a force, you know, an invisible force somewhere. So let me just ask this first question, look at that together. Who is the Holy Spirit? I'm going to reference a lot of different scriptures tonight, and I'm conscious that there's no way, I'm not going to read them all, nor will you have time to sort of look at them as we go. So on the tables as you go out, there's sheets with all of the references that I'll mention. So you can have a wee look at that later on in your own personal study. But last week when Paul was speaking, he explained the reality of two unique persons in the Godhead, God the Father and God the Son, and explained about the distinct roles that Father and Son had. And tonight we're looking at the Holy Spirit, also, of course, part of the Trinity. Mark chapter 1, verse 9 to 11 says this. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." So the scene there is the Son, Jesus, being baptized by John the Baptist, the Spirit descending, and the Father speaking. So you have Father, Son, and Spirit, the Trinity, together. John 14:26 says this, "But the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of everything I have said to you." So you've got the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, sent by the Father, sent in Jesus' name. The Trinity, three in one. He's a person. He's part of that Trinity, this mystery that we know, the majesty and mystery of the Trinity. John 15:26, when speaking about the Holy Spirit, says he. John 16, verse 7, refers to him, the Holy Spirit, and verse 8 again, he. So, when we're thinking about him, Revelation 2:7, he speaks. Romans 8:26, he intercedes. John 15:26, he testifies. These are all references to the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 8, verse 29, he leads. Acts chapter 16, verse 13, he guides. Acts chapter 20, verse 28, he appoints. All of these references, and there's many more as well that you can look through in the Word of God, show characteristics of a person. He's not a supernatural force. He's not a being. He is a person. He's not an experience. He's a person. And that is who we think about. But he's not just a person. He's a divine person. And Paul referenced this last Sunday night when he was teaching the Nicene Creed. He is very God of very God. And his attributes are unique to God. And these are some of them. Hebrews 9, verse 14. He is eternal. Luke 1, 35. He is all-powerful. Psalm 139, verse 7. He is omnipresent. He's everywhere. 1 Corinthians 2, 10 and 11. He is omniscient, all-knowing. Acts 5, 3 and 4. He is God. And then when you read at the beginning of Genesis, he is creator. So in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. But it speaks about the Holy Spirit hovering over the waters. God said, let us make man in our image. In Matthew 28, the Great Commission to the disciples, he commanded them to go into the whole world, baptizing in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. So in answer to the first question, who is the Holy Spirit? He is God. He is God. That's the person. Part of the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, working together in perfect unity. So he is God. Secondly, what does the Holy Spirit do? And there's three different aspects of his work I want to think about here. His work in creation, his work through God's word, and his work in salvation. So firstly, his work in creation. In John chapter 1, verse 1, it shows us the eternal nature of Jesus and his role in the creation of the world. So in the beginning was the Word, Jesus, the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Nothing was made without him. Genesis 1, 2 talks about the Holy Spirit hovering over the water. And then let me read you a part. You can turn to this, Psalm 104. This is a beautiful psalm in terms of God creating and what he has created. So it's Psalm 104. And I just want to read to you the first number of verses. So 1 through 15 from Psalm 104. Praise the Lord, O my soul. O Lord my God, you are very great. You have clothed with splendor. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. He wraps himself in light as with a garment. He stretches out the heavens like a tent and lays the beam of his upper chambers on their waters. He makes the clouds his chariot and rides on the wings of the wind. He makes winds his messenger, flames of fire his servants. He set the earth on its foundations. It can never be moved. You covered it with the deep as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains, but at your rebuke the waters fled. At the sound of your thunder they took to flight. They flowed over the mountains. They went down into the valleys to the place you assigned for them. You set a boundary they cannot cross. Never again will they cover the earth. He makes springs pour water into the ravines. It flows between the mountains. They give water to all the beasts of the field. The wild donkeys quench their thirst. The birds of the air nest by the waters. They sing among the branches. He waters the mountains from his upper chambers. The earth is satisfied by the fruit of his work. He makes grass grow for the cattle and plants for man to cultivate, bringing forth food from the earth, wine that gladdens the heart of man, oil to make his face shine, and bread that sustains his heart. And then note verse 30, when you send your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the earth. The Holy Spirit, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit together in the creation of our world. Secondly, his work through God's word. 2 Peter 1, 20 and 21 says this, above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation of things, for prophecy never had its origin in the human will. But prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. He inspired this book, the Holy Spirit, and he illuminates it to our minds as we come with open hearts and as we come to read it and study it. And John 14, 26 says, but the advocate, the counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of everything I have said to you. So the Holy Spirit illuminates our minds and opens our hearts to receive the truth of God's word. That is a very important aspect of his work. And we need to get it into our brains as we think about that and come to him and come and open our Bibles. And perhaps the opposite of that is seen most clearly when you look at the Pharisees, who had tremendous head knowledge but cold hearts. And Jesus referenced that many, many times when he spoke to them. They knew a lot of the scripture, but it had no outworking in their lives. Their hearts were cold. They were referred to as whitewashed tombs, just what was on the outside. And for us, and this has been a challenge to me as I've thought about it this last couple of weeks, teaching or personal study should never be a purely academic exercise, just coming to get more head knowledge, just get stuff into our brains. It must never be that. Through the Bible, the Holy Spirit gives us historical and doctrinal truth, absolutely, but he uses it to speak into our hearts, because that's what the Word of God is for, isn't it? It's to speak into our hearts. It's to affect a change in our lives. And through the Holy Spirit, he does that. So receiving teaching, whether it be here tonight or wherever it is that you find yourselves, or in your own personal study as well, we should come with hearts and minds that are open to the Holy Spirit, and Bibles that are open as well in that respect. And note the phrase where Jesus said, "He will remind you of everything I have said to you." We had a conversation as a family. Rosemary will fill you in the details of it, but Rosemary had a very practical experience of this, of the Holy Spirit bringing to her mind things, truths, that helped her through a particular time. And I've asked her just to share briefly about that. So the reality of him bringing back into our minds these great truths. So Rosemary's going to come and do that now, and then I'll continue on after that. Thanks, Rosemary.
I've shared this with some of you, so apologies for those who are hearing this for the second time. But as many of you know, at the beginning of last year, I had very unexpected major surgery. You know what it's like after surgery? I was lying that night after I'd had my surgery, and I had drips and syringe drivers, and I was being sick, and nurses were in and out every 5 minutes checking me. And I was lying there thinking, well, I'm not going to get any sleep tonight at all. How am I going to put the night in? And I thought, I really should be praying. And I thought, but what am I going to pray for? There's so much. There's family. There's church. There's people who are ill. There's the world. There's our own country. There's world situations. Where am I going to start? And I just suddenly had a real sense of peace and a real sense of God saying to me, I have this. You don't need to worry. I know what's going on in your family and the church and the world. Just praise me. And I stopped and I started to praise God. And I praised him for the whole night. I never ran out of things to praise him for. And when the morning came, I felt a real sense of awe. And I thought, where did that come from? How was I able to spend all night praising God? And I wasn't repeating things. I kept thinking of more and more and more things I could praise him for. And I just felt that real sense of awe. And I suddenly realized that the Holy Spirit was using what I had learned through the years. And I thought, where have I learned this? And I thought, well, I've learned it through listening to good ministry. I've learned it through reading good books. But probably for me, the main thing was that as a group of women, we've met for over 20 years now, doing inductive Bible studies, in-depth studies. And I just felt that real sense of awe that in a time when I was feeling very low, that the Holy Spirit prompted me right through the night to remember what I had learned, to remember his attributes, his character, the things he had done in my life, the things he'd done in other people's lives, things he'd done right through from the beginning of time. And even before the beginning of time. And I just, as I say, I just felt a sense of awe and a real sense that it was through what I had learnt that the Holy Spirit was able to bring back all those things to me, and I was able to keep praising him. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Rosemary. That's a very practical example of, you know, what we know, what we learn, And the Holy Spirit uses it in our individual lives. And it's an exciting aspect of his work as well, isn't it? That he would do that. Imagine, you know, just there's Rosemary lying in a hospital bed, an Ulster hospital, one person out of whatever many billion are on the earth now. And God, through his Holy Spirit, ministered to her, spoke to her, encouraged her, and transformed that situation. 2 Timothy 3, verse 16, all Scripture is God-breathed, all of it. And is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. And it's not enough to sort of dip in and dip out. And this is a challenge to me as well. It's studying it. It's getting it into our brains. And then he says he will remind us of it. But it needs to be in there first to be reminded of. We need to give the time to it. And we need to get stuck into it. Which is why Stephen Shaw's encouragement, that he gives us a lot when he teaches, the importance of having this book, and the importance of opening this book, and the importance of studying this book. That's why that's such a valid encouragement. And actually, a conversation that Heidi and I have been having recently, this is a little aside, but I would quite often bring my phone with the Bible on it. And actually, I'm not, you do whatever you're comfortable to do. I'm not so sure that's a good idea, actually. I think actually having the Word of God, I'll tell you why. One thing is the Bible app that I use, Bible Gateway, you now have to pay to get ads removed. And I'm too tight to pay to get the ads removed. So when I'm opening it, you know, quite often, it's normally Candy Crush. So I'm waiting for it, and there's that, you know. And it's a distraction when I'm looking at that. And also, I don't want to be a scaremonger, but there's a very real possibility going forward with AI and all that goes with it, that some of these things will be very easy to manipulate and change. And who knows when we are reading on our phone that actually that is what the text says, and it hasn't been some way infiltrated. So that's an aside. That's me saying that. And Heidi and I have had this conversation about the importance of bringing a Bible. Technology is wonderful. It is detrimental in so many respects. I remember as a young guy bringing my Bible all the time and being challenged recently as to how little I actually bring it and have a phone with me as well, instead, because it's very, very handy, of course, to have the phone. So his work through his Word. Thirdly, his work in salvation. Let me read these verses. You can turn to these. John 16, 5 to 11. John 16, 5 to 11. Now, this is Jesus speaking. Now, I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you ask me, where are you going? Because I have said these things, you're filled with grief. But I tell you the truth, it's for your good that I'm going away. Unless I go, the counselor will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will convict the world of guilt in regard to sin and righteousness and judgment. In regard to sin, because men don't believe in me. In regard to righteousness, because I'm going to the Father where you can see me no longer. And in regard to judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. Note, he will convict the world of sin. Of guilt in regard to sin, righteousness, and judgment. Sin, righteousness, and judgment, those are unpopular topics for conversation in 2024 in our society, aren't they? They're uncomfortable for us to bring up, and people really don't want to hear about them either. But this is what it says in 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. The God of this age, Satan, is described in John 8 as the father of lies, and he has blinded the eyes of people around us. John 14, 16 and 17 says, I will ask the Father, he will give you another counselor to be with you forever. And he's described there as the Spirit of Truth. So see, in a world where people are blinded, their eyes are blinded by the prince of this world, Satan, and where they're living by lies, he shines his light into hearts and minds, and his truth unlocks stubborn minds and hearts. Praise God for the Holy Spirit, who opens our blind eyes, who speaks truth to us, through whom we're born again, saved and given hope, purpose, and a future. Let me read that again. Praise God for the Holy Spirit, who opens our blind eyes, who speaks truth to us, through whom we are born again, saved and given hope, purpose, and a future. Isn't that good news? That's the reality of what he's done in our lives. He has opened our eyes. His truth has radically changed. His light has shone in. And he's opened our blinded eyes. In Revelation, the multitude who stood before the throne cried out, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." Salvation is his work. There's two dangers of how we work this out and how we think about it. We acknowledge that and realize we're incapable of doing anything. So we don't need to do anything. So we just sit back and do nothing. Well, that negates actually the teaching of the Lord, the apostles and the early church, where we're commanded to go into the world, proclaim the gospel and to make disciples. Or secondly, we forget that it's his work and we try and do it in our own strength and merits. We need to be creative, absolutely. We need to take opportunities. We need to be confident. We need to be courageous. But it's not our work. It's his work. It's the Holy Spirit who convicts of sin. It's not us. And we can present the truth. But in doing that, we need to pray that God's Holy Spirit would open blind eyes. And that God's Holy Spirit would soften hardened hearts. And that God's Holy Spirit would speak truth into people who believe all sorts of rubbish and nonsense. And let me just remind you of something we've been doing as a church over this past year or so. So some of you will still have these somewhere in your phone or your purse or whatever, these wee cards, Faith with a Focus. And the verses were Mark 5:18-20. So the man after had just been healed, and he wanted to stay with Jesus. And Jesus said to him, "Go home to your family, tell them everything the Lord has done for you and how merciful he has been." And the suggested prayer or mindset on the back of the card, "Bring into my life today one friend, colleague, family member, whoever may cross my path, who is open to hearing the truth about Jesus. Give me the courage and wisdom needed to respond to the opportunity, whether by showing them kindness, offering to read the Bible together, come along with them to Hope Explored, inviting them to church, or simply sharing the gospel. Even now, work on their life to bring them into a personal relationship with Jesus." Whose work is that? It's the Holy Spirit's work. And as we pray that, that's what we pray, that he works. And it may well be you've been doing that, and if you haven't, there's a number of those wee cards on the tables where the handouts where the verses are as well. But let me encourage you to do that and to take those and to pray into that. And let me give you a practical example of that. Many of you will know that for the last number of years I've been chaplain at Orange Rangers. So that looks like, you know, going to training and various other things, meeting with people. But as often as I can, going on a Saturday afternoon just down to the matches. So the play just where Tesco is, that new nursing home, it's a pitch directly behind it. I just go there to be a presence and hopefully to have an opportunity. And another guy who's a chaplain for Green Island, Dave Wilson, who works with Precept, him and I had a conversation recently just about how mammoth the task is, all those people. And so many of them seemingly not particularly interested in hearing about the reality of God. So he says what he does is he prays for one conversation just whenever he goes. So I've started to do that. And a couple of Saturdays ago, I went down, and on the way down in the car, I just prayed, "Lord, would you give me one clear opportunity today to speak about you? One opportunity." So I went down, watched the match. They lost, so they were a wee bit grumpy. And then afterwards, to where the first team was, and they were all sort of sitting, and they weren't really for engaging very much because they weren't particularly happy that the game hadn't gone too well. I went through the other part of the club, and they had the Liverpool-Brighton match on. And at that stage, Brighton were winning 1-0, which was magnificent. Liverpool turned it around and won. So, I mean, it just was not... The atmosphere wasn't great. I was about to leave. And about 15 or 20 minutes, he says, "I'm going to go home." And this guy came up. His wife hadn't been too well. So I just said to him, "Tell me, how's your wife?" And it just opened up. My goodness me, such a conversation. And he started to engage about prayer, you know, asking me about prayer and how does that work and healing. And a real clear, well, why did that happen? I believe it happens because on the way down in the car, I said, "God, would you give me one clear opportunity today to speak about you?" And I firmly believe that the Holy Spirit worked in his heart that day and brought that conversation about. It wasn't coincidence. I believe firmly that that was the Holy Spirit because it's his work. He uses us. Praise God in his grace and his mercy. He uses us. It's not our work. It's his work. And we need to depend on the power that is available through the Holy Spirit. God reveals wonderful things to us by his word, through his Spirit. And the Spirit of God takes the word of God and makes a child of God. Isn't that wonderful? And we can all attest to that experience. Where our eyes have been opened, the word of God, the scriptures, our eyes have been opened. We've seen his truth. His Holy Spirit has convicted us. We've come into relationship with him and we've trusted him. It's his work. It's not our work. Lastly, And arguably, maybe most importantly for us, as we take teaching and acknowledge that it's not just academic head knowledge, but what do we actually do with it? Behind me on this stage, it's here every Sunday morning, and I wonder how many of us look at it, the vision statement. And it's not just a nice wee strap line. There's been thought and prayer put into it, but let me read it to you. Our vision for the Christians in Scrabble is that we would be devoted followers of Jesus Christ, who know God in an intimate way through the Word of God, through reading, praying, studying the Word of God, and His Holy Spirit illuminates it to us, who grow in Jesus. So it's not just academic head knowledge, but we ask the Holy Spirit to challenge us and to change us, and we grow in our faith and we mature in our faith, who show their love for each other. So that's here in the context of church, our brothers and sisters, as we love and care for one another, but it's also in the context of outside. And go with the gospel of Jesus Christ to share it with our communities. Finish it there, and it is quite, it's good. I think it's good anyway. But finish it there, and actually, the most important aspect of it, we negate and we ignore. To the glory of God in the power of the Holy Spirit. All of those things are only possible through the power of the Holy Spirit. We can do them, but they're completely ineffectual if it's not in the power of the Holy Spirit, and acknowledging that. All those things are good, so we can know in a particular way more about God. We can grow, we can show. But actually, that last line, to the glory of God and the power of the Holy Spirit, that is what we need to be doing, each of us. Employing His power in our lives, allowing His power in our lives, inviting His power into our lives, and utilizing His power, or rather, Him utilizing us through His power. And the reality of the difference it makes or should make in our lives is a very sobering one. 1 Corinthians 3:16, don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit lives in you? That's a very sobering thought, isn't it? The very Holy Spirit of God, His holy presence, lives in our lives. He lives here. He's present here. Whenever Ellie was much, much younger, and a rainy day, and you know what it's like as parents trying to sort of come up with stuff to do in the house, and she used to love playing hide and seek. So one of the first times we played it, she was only about five or something like that, and I'm trying to explain to her how you play it. And at that stage, her bed upstairs had a gap underneath it. So I'm, you know, downstairs, right, you go and hide, I'll count to 10. So I'm 1, 2, and you can hear wee footsteps going up. She went up the stairs in their bedroom, and she put her head under the bed. Her whole body was lying out in their bedroom. Just her head was under the bed. And in her mind, she thought, I can't see him, he'll not be able to see me. It's silly, isn't it? Well, do you know what? How many of us do that, if we're honest with God? There's no one else from church here at the minute where I am. I'm on my own. No one can see. How many of us do that? It's just as childish, isn't it, in terms of our faith? It's actually ridiculous that we do that. He lives in our hearts. God's Holy Spirit lives in our hearts. And that's a massive challenge. He is holy. Well, what do? In those so-called hidden times when no one's around, the stuff that we look at, the stuff that we think about, the things that we say about brothers and sisters in Christ, all of that stuff, it's not hidden from Him. He knows it all because He resides in our very hearts. There's nowhere, Psalm 139, where can I flee from your Spirit? Well, the answer is nowhere. He is everywhere. And that is a huge challenge, I think, to each of us, the outworking of this in our lives. What He does, who He is, yes, but what does that mean in our lives as we try and live out our faith? And we can grieve Him, of course, can't we? By the way that we live and the things that we do. If we are born again, then we're a new creation. And if that's true, then we're to live our lives guided by the Holy Spirit. Not what we think, not what we want, but guided by the Holy Spirit. Every day, allowing Him access into every aspect, every area of our lives, to bring glory to God. Galatians 5:16. So I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. The Message translation puts it like this, and I like it. Live freely, animated and motivated by God's Spirit. I love that phrase. Animated, that means you're not just sitting still, waiting for some miracle to happen. Animated means you're doing something. You're following in obedience. Animated and motivated. So the Holy Spirit of God has such a grip on our lives that we're going in His power And we're motivated by his truth as we take it to a world that so badly needs to hear it. Actually, do you want to turn, just as we finish off, to Galatians 5, and let's look at some of these verses together. Galatians 5, 16. So I say, live by the Spirit, and you won't gratify the desires of the sinful nature. Verse 17, the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They're in conflict with each other, so that you do not do what you want. I don't need to explain that to you, sure don't. There's that conflict. You probably experience it every day of your lives. There's a conflict here between the old nature, the sinful nature, and the new nature. There's a conflict between what we want and what the Holy Spirit wants in our lives, if we're honest. But there should be fruit. Well, there's two types of fruit mentioned here. There's the fruit or the acts when we live by the sinful nature. Verses 19 to 21. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies and the like. I warn you as I did before, those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. Message translation of those verses. It's obvious what kind of life develops out of trying to get your own way all the time. Repetitive, loveless, cheap sex, a stinking accumulation of mental and emotional garbage, frenzied and joyless grabs for happiness, trinket gods, magic show religion, paranoid loneliness, cutthroat competition, all-consuming yet never satisfied wants, a brutal temper, an impotence to love or be loved, divided homes, divided lives, small-minded and lopsided pursuits, the vicious habit of depersonalizing everyone into a rival, uncontrolled and uncontrollable addictions, ugly parodies of community. And you hear that list and say, hang on a minute here, that's not me. No way am I living in that way. But it's not about not doing things, just not doing things, not doing those things. Those are the acts of the sinful nature. It doesn't finish there. It's not about not just doing stuff. It's about producing fruit when we're living by the Spirit. That's what we're called to do, produce fruit. There has to be evidence. There has to be something obvious. In one of the RE lessons that I do in school for the children of Israel coming out of the Promised Land, I have these. Now, if you're sitting down, probably no matter where you're sitting, actually, they look reasonably realistic. Even if you're up close to them, they're reasonably realistic. If you were to bite into one of those grapes, they're rubber. So it's not going to be pleasant. So, they look the part. They serve the purpose. Do you know what? See, as Christians, brothers and sisters, it's no good to look the part. It doesn't do. It's no good. And we all do it if we're honest. You can play the game. You know how it works. You know how to do church. You know how to do the Christian thing. You look the part. That's not good enough. And it's not just a matter of not doing that stuff that we think the world does. That's not good enough. We're called to live by the Spirit. And when we do live by the Spirit, we're called to produce fruit. That's what we're called to do. And it's mentioned here, or they're mentioned here, the things that we're called to do. Verses 22 to 26. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. How are you doing with those things? If I were to put the other list up there, it would probably be relatively easy to go through and say, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that. But I wonder, when you put that list up, I wonder how many of you can go through and say, I do that, I do that. Well, that's the call of the Holy Spirit living in our lives, to produce fruit. It has to be obvious. Not so that people look at us and say, here, aren't they good? No, no, no. In the power of the Holy Spirit, what? For the glory of God. That's why we live like that. And we are called to live and to keep in step with the Spirit. How are you doing with that every day of your life? Are you down or off, going your own direction? Your own wants and your own desires and your own hopes and your own dreams? Are you in step with His will for your life, all of it? Not just the bit that's left over when you've done what you want to do. That's what the call to live by the Holy Spirit is. That's what it looks like, or that's what it should look like in our lives. That we're producing fruit and we're living in His power and we're obedient to Him and we're making an impact in this world that so badly needs the reality of Christ and His truth and His light. Let me read a few lines from this book. I've referenced this before, used some of these before, Every Moment Holy. So it's a guy, Doug McKelvey, who the first two volumes of this he wrote. And the first one was just liturgies, prayers, poems for everyday life. The second one was specifically in and around grief and loss. And this one is the work of the people. So it's lots of different contributors, of which Heidi Johnston has contributed two excellent liturgies to. This is not by Heidi, this is by Doug. And it's praise to Christ who labours through his people. O Christ, exalted Prince of Heaven, O Christ, radiant King of Earth, your glories are everlasting. You are the living head of your body, the divine bridegroom of your church. You are the desire of all nations. You hold authority over death and life, over all peoples and kingdoms, over all principalities and powers. All creation is your inheritance. You are the fullness that fills all things. Through you all things were created, and by your redeeming works all things will be made new. All glory and power are yours, O Christ. You lack nothing. Indeed, you don't even need us, O Lord. You do not need your children, and yet you call us. And calling us, you choose to labour in and among us, accomplishing your holy purposes through a most unlikely people. Who are we that you have chosen us to bear your name, O Christ? Who are we that you have invited us to serve as your hands and feet, co-labouring with you unto the quiet increase of your eternal kingdom? Apart from you, we have nothing to offer but our weakness and our insufficiency. Yet when we bring these things to you, you delight in using our poverty to display your riches of grace and our weakness to display your great strength. For this, we give you praise. Apart from you, we can do nothing. We prove this over and over. But, and get this, when we abide in you and draw our life from you, we become as flourishing branches, nourished by your roots, coursing with your life, bearing much good fruit. So let it be, O Lord, in our lives and in our churches. Amen. That's the reality of living by the person of the Holy Spirit, the truth, the one who illuminates his scripture to us, who changes our lives, who convicts men and women and young people of sin, and who uses us to bring much glory and much honour to his name. And let's grasp the reality of that and live with him every day at the centre of our lives. The praise team are going to come. We're going to sing one final praise piece together, and then we'll stand after that, and I'll close in prayer.
Thank you.
Father God, thank you that you promised the gift of the Counselor, the Advocate, the Holy Spirit. And thank you that he came in power. And thank you that he resides in our very hearts. And we praise you for that. And Lord, help us to really get the weight of that, the very presence of God in our lives daily. And help us also to get the excitement of that, that your power, God, in our lives to bring about change, not for our glory, but for your glory. And Father, I pray that each of us would allow him more access in our lives. And Father, that we would know more about you as we grow in our faith, that we would show the reality of that as we love one another and go into this world in the power of the Holy Spirit, and that he would open blind eyes, and that he would convict men and women and young people of their sin and bring them into relationship with you for your glory, God. And we pray in his power that that would be accomplished. I pray that my thoughts, Lord, if they haven't already, would be completely forgotten, but that your holy word would continue to shape and change us for your glory. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.